sadness. So Rahul is the head of the viral testing facility at Xinjiang International, and he will be sharing with us on the challenges in viral clearance studies, experiences, and learning. So I'd like to hand over the time now to Rahul to say a few words as well as to share his presentation.
Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, Rahul, we can hear you.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to all participants. Thank you for joining this virtual conference. And this is one of the unique experiences that we are all going through. Hope you all are keeping safe and healthy in these tough times. With this challenges, I'm equally excited to share my views on the viral clearance studies in biologics programs that Xinjiang has so far gone through while executing the client studies. So I'm going to present those challenges in form of some essential pointers and tips to all the participants listening over here. And in case if you have any queries, please do drop them to our Xinjiang site, as well as you can also share it with the organizers. I would be happy to take them up and answer them as well at any given point of time. Right. So I start my presentation. So the premise of the viral clearance is based on the ICH guideline Q5A, which talks about executing the viral clearance studies which are applicable for the biologics programs, which involves the use of mammalian cell culture systems, where the inherent risk of viruses comes into picture. And hence, regulators expect that a viral safety approach has to be adopted, which involves the use of selection of the source material for the which are free of viruses, the selection of cell lines that are initially characterized and known to be free of viruses. Second, during the stage of manufacturing, if there is any viruses that could have propped up due to the introduction of the raw materials or failures of GMP. The testing is something that has to be done in the intermediate stages of harvest so that the viruses can be detected. As well, another approach or complementary approach would be to introduce the clearance capability, evaluate the clearance of the manufacturing process for removal or inactivation of viruses. So all this, the three-prong approach is desirable because we know that each of these processes have their own limitations and none of those approach provides you sufficient assurance. So this comes because of the inherent theoretical and the real risk that persists from the due to transmission of the viruses. That could be coming from the adventitious viruses being introduced due to the process additives or due to the contamination of bioreactors as an event of failures of the GMP process or systems. And some of them are evolving due to the concerns of new and emerging viruses that could get into the manufacturing at any stage from environment or from people who are working with these in these programs. And some other risks being the theoretical risk of the endogenous viruses, which we have been known for quite some time, and still we continue to deal with it in form of doing the risk assessments as well as understanding the retroviruses being expressed during the stages of fermentation. And hence it becomes essential that each of these approaches be adopted. A risk assessment has to be performed And that's the approach that regulators expect for the manufacturers to take place. So this is one schematic which tells about how we can build the viral safety at different stages of manufacturing. It starts from selection of the raw materials which have been tested to be free of viruses, selection of the cell banks which have been well characterized for their purity, identity, as well as ensure that they are free of viruses. Then take them for your clones, preparation of your clones for the target, and then take them into your manufacturing. Do a risk assessment of your manufacturing as well to ensure that at any stages of your upstream, are there any chances of introducing a risk of viruses into the facility and thereby into the product. And then going to the intermediate stages where you can do the testing and eventually in the downstream ensure and build a robust virus clearance so that you have all these three-pronged approach which is going into your risk assessment and ensuring and giving you a confidence that the product that is being manufactured is free of viruses. So out of the three approaches, I am going to talk today more on the viral clearance. What was our experience while executing this for the biologics manufacturers, our clients, and what were the learnings that I would like to share with the audience today here. So the main objective of virus clearance is about a manufacturing process should be able to effectively remove or inactivate viruses that might be coming from the starting material or from the failures of your GMP, as well as it provides an indirect evidence that the production process can take care of the future risk from the unpredictable viral contaminants. The approach that can be adopted to do this to ensure virus clearance is by targeting the different biophysical properties of the viruses, like the presence, the envelope, targeting the presence or absence of envelope, targeting the removal of or disintegration of the genome, which could be the DNA or RNA genome, or biophysical separation on the size basis of the viral particles. So from for the large to small viruses, you can have the approach of introducing the physical removals by size exclusions, and then also targeting the physicochemical resistance of the virus, where you can have the understanding of high and low category of viruses and ensure that you introduce such kind of inactivation steps which can help to overcome the resistance of these viruses. And some of the approaches where you can have on the charge basis, where you can use some specific buffer conditions which helps to ensure that the viruses can be removed on the charge basis. Another, to target those removals of viruses, the basis you can use is you can disrupt the viral particle, the components of the viruses like the genomes or the envelope proteins or the protein codes, and also help ensure that you can do the separation on the basis of the size of the particle or ionic interaction by doing the ion exchange chromatographies, whether it is cation exchange, anion exchange, or mixed mode is what you can adopt and take those approaches. Now, a lot of literatures are available on the scientific websites and journals, in the journals, which can help you to give you the confidence that all the existing steps, can they be useful for introducing them as a viral clearance steps. While doing these studies for our clients, these we have got through some of the good experiences and that we have come across while executing studies for our Indian clients, our US and European clients for their and helping them to submit for their phase one and phase three clinical trial applications. It has been a very good learning experience for all of us here that there were good and open interactions with all these clients, which helped us to also give them useful tips and pointers while executing the studies. Some of these experiences came through for while doing the exploratory studies for the clients where they wanted to explore batch chromatographies or batch mode steps, whereas some of the new approaches of continuous mode have been also evaluated in our laboratory. And it has been challenging times for us as well. And these were done and executed for the products like monoclonal antibodies. Few clients came for the polyclonal antibodies where they had the antibodies expressed in animals and being used for the filing in WHO agencies. And two clients came for ancillary reagents for the therapeutic purpose. So it has been really vivid experience for us. Although not many studies we have been able to do, but whatever track record so far we established, it was a very learning experience. And that's what I wanted to showcase today to this group of audience. So one of the early stage of learnings was that do an early planning. Start the discussions with the testing laboratories at an early stage. Discuss the scale down models with the testing laboratory scientific team so that it gives the confidence that what kind of clearance can be attained and achieved basis of their prior experience. Accordingly, the manufacturers can plan their batch, which they can dedicate for generating the materials for the viral clearance purpose, establish the whole time stability of data, because it is very essential that the time frame in which you want to execute and the time frame for the availability of the slots in these testing laboratories may not coincide. So your whole time stability is very essential over here to ensure and give you the confidence that these are the stages and these product intermediates will stay stable till the time you have been able to execute the studies. Decide on the shipments of these process intermediates, resins coming from the manufacturing, so that that what would be the way in which you are able to ship them comfortably and confidently to the manufacturing, to the testing site. Also plan for shipment of the scaled down columns. It could be coming as a pre-packed column from a third party, or you can also plan an on-site packing of these columns. Another aspect is about discussion of the scaled down study designs and the selection of these process steps. So first and foremost activity is to identify from your existing manufacturing process steps which are the ones which can give me confidence on giving the log reduction or the virus reduction. What is the existing information that I have around these steps? What is it that the industry has been doing around these steps? How much of log clearance have they achieved, which have been coming out in the published articles? Can all the steps be validated? Is it really fruitful for me to consider all of the process steps in my manufacturing to the viral clearance, or only few? We need to also do is to understand how much of clearance I have to attain. For this, you need to look into the ICH guidance. It clearly states about in the way in which you need to demonstrate the viral clearance log reductions by understanding the load of the viral particles in your bulk harvest for a single drug substance. So based on that, single dose is what you will have understanding and coming out with the number. And based on that, these numbers and assumptions is what you will boil down to the number of steps that you want to select for the viral clearance. And do we need to also see that what are the guidances that are available, which is very essential, in which part of the globe you want to do the regulatory filing? What are the guidances in those part of the globes telling about the viral clearance requirements? Understand that, align your requirement accordingly. And going forward, also the operating space should consider the influence of the process parameters, setting up the in-process limits for these process parameters. For example, the flow rates, the mixing rates, column dimensions, reuse studies, how much of the cycles my resin can last, and will the viral clearance also last to that those many number of cycles? What is the protein content that I am going to load, or my manufacturing is typically going to get in my during my routine batches, and is it sufficient load for the resins to also demonstrate the viral clearance? What are the pH conditions? Consider the worst case scenarios also while considering the pH conditions. Will it also, in what way it will impact the viral clearance? The temperature, moisture content, any significant impact it is happening on the virus clearance has to be evaluated during your risk assessments. These are some of the important conditions. And then also understand that if you have your manufacturing antibodies, does it adversely impacts on the virus clearance, or is it going to be supportive? That understanding has to be taken into consideration in the early stages. So in all these things, it's very important and essential that the exploratory studies are done well ahead of time with your process feeds, because those are the data and indicators that you will get that when you are going for a clinical trial application study, and you are not going to expect any surprises. When you are going for your later, when your molecule has gone into the later phase of the developments and going to go for the phase 3 and the marketing authorization applications, you need to also demonstrate the worst case conditions are robust enough for your viral clearance. So you have to challenge the viral clearance steps like chromatographies with low protein conditions, different flow throughs, rates, the column loading of columns with higher product volumes. Will it also impact the viral clearance? The pH of operations, inactivation, how the inactivation will be impacted during those conditions. And for your viral filtration kind of steps, will the flux and the pressure pause conditions adversely impact the viral clearance? That should be understood. So all the column carryover studies, the resin lifetime has to be understood. These are the things that one has to keep in mind in the early stage of your development, and perform some of the exploratory studies with your process feeds in the contract labs, because they are the ones which gives you an indication that yes, my steps are really robust, and they are the ones which will give me the confidence of batch over batch when I'm going into my commercial manufacturing. Other than the process designs and the study design, I'm also going to talk on some of the part of the assays side, so that these are also the equally important points that one has to keep in mind. So plan your mock studies. This is another thing that one should have few days in advance of executing your real spiking studies. so that the mock studies give you the kind of baseline understanding that once my feed is spiked with the virus spiking media conditions, how does it impact on the process performance? Does it really gives me a different kinds of process run conditions, or is it still meeting the criteria which I have done in my site? So I understand the impact of the virus purity. So viruses are also grown in the culture medias, which are in the feed properties of these are different from the ones which the process have been encountering from the regular ones. So the virus when they are cultured, they also bring in some kind of impurities, and these impurities are be taken into considerations because there will be some impurity which will come along with the purified virus stock, and this should be low enough on that it does not adversely impact when the virus spiking is done. So the pure virus stocks are the desirable ones, and they are really effective for the viral filtration and the chrome study. So the pure virus stocks are something that one has to use during these two steps at least. The right choice of virus is important to demonstrate intended mode of clearance. If your mode of clearance is for the inactivation, you need to choose the envelope virus and not the non-envelope. So you, and when you have the target for the viral filtration, it's the smallest non-envelope virus that you should target to demonstrate the robustness of your process. So this is what it means. And then the virus titers when for the hold control and the load samples are the ones which should be considered, and the variability of these titers coming from the outcome of these two samples should be within the variability limits as demonstrated in the guidance documents. So otherwise the calculations of the log reduction has to be considered the ones which is showing the lesser log reduction and lesser titer values. The high titer of virus is desirable, so wherever it is feasible, use the high titered virus, but with a rider that do not overspike them. Even if it is high titered, you need to understand how much of clearance you want to target and specifically try to spike to that extent so that you do not see a breakthrough in virus, because at times high titers may help, may give you a good clearance, but if it is too much spike, it may break through and defy the purpose of claiming the higher log clearance. The spike optimization study is helpful in attaining the optimal performance, and so these spike optimization studies are the ones which I was talking about, that the exploratory studies will give you that understanding. Whenever you have an early stage of development happening, also try to see that the PI of the virus and the molecules are checked, because at times there are molecules which are having a PI closer to the to that of the virus. The virus tends to coevolute in the product fraction. So this is where one has to take this into consideration. It's typically for cases where you have PI coming closer to the virus. Otherwise, it's not that relevant. Conductivity also plays a part. So I do have some slides in the later in the presentation where I am going to talk about this, that how the change in conductivity impacts the virus clearance. While doing the preliminary studies where the cytotoxicity and interference is involved, it must be kept in mind that these runs should be performed keeping the duration of the spiking runs in mind. So for example, if your spiking run duration is going to be around 4 hours or 5 hours, so while doing the interference studies, especially it should be known that the virus and the feed is exposed for the that much duration of time, and then it is taken for the assays. Otherwise, you tend to see some different characteristics or the morphology in the outcome of the assays. So apart from that, I am going to talk on the fitness of the assays. So assays must be validated. It should be sensitive enough to detect low count of virus. Perform a large volume plating where you have the confidence of attaining the good clearance, and where you see you know that the virus particles are not going to come through. Include relevant controls for ensuring that the samples are handled properly and the cell lines are permeable to the viruses. There are certain other limitations to the infectivity assays that that are performed. For example, the plaque morphology is something that is important. At times, virus characteristics may change the nature of CPs. There are sometimes infectious particles are not detected in the permeable cell line. That could be because of the inactivation of the particle itself, or since there is a decrease in sensitivity potential of the indicator cell line, or change in the ability of cells due to the presence of the sample matrix. And at times, the biological activity of the molecule or the product itself interferes in demonstrating the infectivity nature in the indicator cells. So these are the limitations that one has to keep in mind. Also, during sometimes false positive effects are seen, that could be because of the sample matrix showing some morphological changes, or the product biological activity may induce these kind of cell death observations. So another pointer is the laboratories have to ensure good cell culture practices to adopt to ensure that the results coming out are consistent. So they should be following aseptic techniques, good cell line segregation, adherence to the set passages and confluences, so that you know these kind of effects, the false effects are nullified, and use the qualified cell lines or indicator cells for the assay purpose.
Rahul, sorry to interject. We need to move on. The time is already past 25 minutes. So if you could wrap up.
Sure. Thank you. So now I come to the one of the last part of my talk is on the impact, COVID-19 impact that has been as a result of this impact. One of the things which regulatory agencies have come out with is the guidance, which was from the FDA. The GFI has come out in June 2020, where it recommends the manufacturers to perform a risk assessment of the current viral clearance capabilities, and in light of the COVID-19, is it capable enough for them to take care of the SARS-CoV-2 as well? So some of the studies related to the cell lines, will the virus propagate in this cell, in their production cell line, and do they have any kind of assurance from their viral clearance that even the existing steps can take care of SARS-CoV-2 virus? Are some of the strategies that are recommended by the from the FDA? So I would recommend and encourage the participants to go through these guidance to get an update on the updated guidelines. And another thing is some of the during these tough times, clients are not able to come down on the sites. So they have been asking that can the contract lab perform the testing on behalf of them? Yes, if the knowledge transfer is executed properly and that can be validated by the clients, this is what Syngene can offer for the clients by performing the viral clearance studies on behalf of the clients. And so I would just like to rush through some of the case studies, the basis of the experiences that we have gone through. especially for so far for the ion exchange step, as I was telling that the change in that we have gone through some of the varied types of ion exchange steps, and the change in conductivity has made a difference in the clearance for the viruses such as the MVM, the minute virus of mice, and from and the lower the conductivity, the better it is for such for the MVM. Second is on the nanofiltration side is where I was trying to say that spike right, do not over spike if the virus titers are really high. So as you notice in this slide, that the total viral count of around 7 and all up 7 and above has given the breakthrough in virus, whereas the ones which was below or around 7 was the ones which has helped to give us a robust clearance of close to 5 logs. This is another impact of the virus purity that we observed for the sensitive filters, where we did a baseline study. The blue dots is what shows about the baseline study without the virus spike, whereas the green dots is where we did the study by spiking in the equilibration buffer at 1%, and we use a chromatography purified virus to demonstrate that there was no change in the throughput and the flux throughout the period of the study. But the moment we spike this virus with the product feed, the product virus interactions had an adverse impact on the virus separation, and we saw that there was a drop in the throughput. And in the next slide, again, we saw that the change in the percentage of the virus spiking from 1% to 0.5% made a difference in the throughput, improvement of the throughput and the flux. Although in both cases, we were able to complete the study, but the flux went down to 85% when the virus spiking was around 1%, whereas it was redundant to 70%.
Rahul,
when it was 0.5%.
I'm so sorry to interrupt. We are actually past 30 minutes already. So
okay.
Could you quickly wrap up? Yes.
Yes, this is my last slide. And the two exploratory study slides that I'm trying to show is on the ion exchange chromatography, the new type of evidence that we show that the change in conductivity made an impact on the removal clearance of the MVM virus, and we also evaluated the depth filtration as one of the new steps for claiming the viral clearance, which the client was interested to know about. And this was something a good understanding that we had for demonstrating clearance of a robust virus like MVM. And in my last slide, I'm trying to show that one of the research studies where the acidic PI molecule was challenged for the virus clearance using the enveloped virus. That the CEX step was able to give us a good clearance of greater than 4 logs, whereas affinity gave us a clearance of 2.7 odd logs. And with that, I would like to conclude my sharing of experience, and wanted to say that stay safe and take precautions and follow social distancing, which is the message from my team to all of you. I would be happy to take any questions through directly or through the sponsors of the conference. And thank you, the sponsors, for giving me the chance to present in this virtual platform.
Thank you so much, Rahul. It was a very insightful presentation, and I'm so sorry the time overshot. We won't be able to take any questions at the moment. However, I do see some questions that have come in, so please do direct your questions to Rahul. I'm sure that he'll be very happy to continue the discussion with you. So do log on to WOVA's networking section and get in conversation with Rahul. to continue the conversation. Once again, my apologies, for not being able to do the Q&A bit for this presentation.
Not a problem.
Thank you so much once again, Rao.
Thank you. So bye-bye.
Now we are moving on to the next speaker. We have Horst Aruparth from Charles River Laboratories. He is the Scientific and Portfolio Director for Global Biologics Testing Solutions. So without further ado, I'd like to invite Horst to say a few words, as well as to share his presentation on viral risk mitigation strategy for auxiliary agents.